Hello everyone, and a very warm welcome from the UK to today's online service. I'm Mike and this is my wife Jackie, and we're part of the senior leadership team here at King's Church International in Windsor. And it's our great privilege to introduce today's service.
As always, we give a very special welcome to everyone from King's Church International in Windsor, in London and in Robertson, South Africa, and everyone joining us from around the UK and other nations. Wherever you are in the world, please know you are very welcome as you join us.
And wow, what an amazing week we've just had with the UK G12 conference. It was so special to gather together online and to hear inspiring messages from Pastor Cesar Castellanos and Pastor Andrew Catano from Bogota in Colombia, plus many pastors, including our own senior pastor, Wes Richards. We'll be sharing some highlights and feedback from the conference later in the programme.
The UK G12 conference finished last night with a wonderful time of worship led by Martin Smith and his band at the Emmanuel Centre in London, which is the home of KCI London. And we'll be sharing some highlights of this special worship celebration in next week's programme. Today, we will hear one of the preachers from the conference by Pastor Cesar Castellanos.
But first, as always, let's pray. Lord Jesus, we thank you and we praise you that you are the Lord of all creation and your natural of order things is for things to multiply. And Lord Jesus, we thank you for everything we've heard this past week at this G12 conference where the theme was anointed to multiply. So today, as we come here together to praise and worship you, help us come with open hearts to receive from you, to receive your message via anointed pastors. So we know, Lord, that there are going to be some greater things to come than we have ever seen before here at KCI. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Let's worship now together.
Glory for all you brought me through. was a wretch, I remember who I was. I was lost, I was blind, I was running out of time. Sin separated, the breach was far too wide. But from the dark side of the chasm, you had me in your sight. So you made a way across the great divide, left behind heaven's throne to build it here inside. And there at the cross, you paid the debt I owed, broke my chains, freed my soul for the first time I.
Jesus, you have saved my life. Romans 12, verse 1 and 2. Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship.
Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing and perfect will.
Philippians 3, verse 12 to 14. Not that I have already obtained all this, or have already arrived at my goal, but I press on to take hold of that for which Christ Jesus took hold of me. Brothers and sisters, I do not consider myself yet to have taken hold of it.
But one thing I do, forgetting what is behind and straining towards what is ahead, I press on towards the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus.
2 Chronicles 7 verse 14. If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and will heal their land.
2 Corinthians 4 verse 16 to 18. Therefore, we do not lose heart though outwardly we are wasting away, yet inwardly we are being renewed day by day. For our light and momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal glory that far outweighs them all. So we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but on what is unseen. Since what is seen is temporary, but what is unseen is eternal.
Ephesians 3, 17 to 21.
And I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, may have power, together with all the Lord's holy people, to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God.
Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen.
Are you ready to give him praise right now?
Well, a very special welcome to the UK G12 2022 online conference from here in the heart of Windsor.
We are so happy that we can join together from different churches in the UK and in different places.
So let me give you a heads up on what's coming up. We're going to have some video reports in each session from different churches.
Hey everyone, welcome to Leeds and Vision Church. In the past year, we've had some difficult times, Leeds United, as some of you may have seen. But thankfully, we conquered, we came through, and we're still in the Premier League. And I'm not sure what you guys have gone through as individuals. Maybe you've had a difficult couple of years with COVID, with lockdown, but thankfully you're here today, persevering in the vision and listening to the conference and all that God has in store for you.
I think one of the most beautiful things about this great vision is God's heart to restore and raise up priestly families that will reflect his heart to this generation. And so we're encouraged and we're excited at what God is doing. We're projecting ahead this year for God to do amazing things, to see a multiplication. And of course, together as churches with you all, we're believing for God to release great revival in the United Kingdom.
Hi, we are John and Hayley, part of Pastor Wes and Adriana Senior 12 at King's Church International. As a church, we have seen God's faithfulness to us over many seasons.
We currently have 458 cell members across 88 cells and run life classes and three levels of destiny training in three seasons in the year.
As a couple, we share with so many others in the church a confidence that now is the time of salvation, Amen. Multiplication, and acceleration. We believe this online conference will give us further encouragement to believe the promises from Isaiah 60 verse 22, that the least of you will become a thousand, the smallest a mighty nation. I am the Lord. In its time, I will do this swiftly.
Amen.
We're also going to have some online worship and hear from different preachers from Colombia and the UK, starting tonight with the wonderful Pastor Cesar Castellanos, founder of the G12 Vision.
Today, I would like to share a message called The Power of Multiplication. It is interesting that Jesus, the first thing that he said to the first couple was, be fruitful and multiply. Now, the part about being fruitful and multiplying, it is subsequent to having a personal encounter with Jesus. I believe that Christian life, it becomes a real life when you have experienced a personal encounter with Christ. In my case, I came to know the Lord when I was 18 years old. I thought to myself, Lord, I would like to set an appointment with you. I will see you tomorrow, 10:30 p.m. in my living room. That night, I kept all the lights off, everything was off, and I sat in my favorite couch, and I prayed a short little prayer, and I said, Lord Jesus, I don't know you, I don't know who you are, but if you are the God of the Bible, I want you to do something, change me, but do it now. After about 15 minutes, something amazing happened. From outside, there was a very bright light coming towards the door. It was the size of a person. Suddenly it trespassed the door and came to where I was. It actually stopped right next to me. I knew that that person was Jesus. Jesus, he began to guide me every day. He was guiding me in the way that I should pray, in the way that I should relate to God.
You know, when God calls us, he anoints us. And you know, God has given us an amazing calling. Every one of us that are connected to this conference, we are called. We need to love our calling. We need to not be afraid of our calling. If God called us, he will help us. If God calls us, he anoints us. And therefore, we mustn't be afraid. Stop running away from your calling. Stop being irresponsible. Stop being selfish and be loving and share the gospel of Jesus Christ with other people that need the gospel. He has called us to go and make disciples. But he promises, I will be with you all the days, even unto the end of the world.
As a disciple of this vision, I had understood the importance of having a healed heart, which means to have a heart free from painful experiences from the past, a forgiving heart that can receive and give love to the others. A heart like the heart of Jesus. You cannot be racked in your words or rude with the people. Just as Jesus is gentle with us, so we must be gentle even when people oppose us. Only God can really heal our hearts and to give us his spirit, which will help us on every step of our lives.
Multiplication is one of the major themes of the Bible. The God of the Bible is not a God of limitation or stagnation, but a God of growth and expansion, which is seen throughout the Bible. Multiplication is a sign that we are living close to Christ and that we are real disciples who bring glory to God. John 15:8, this is to my Father's glory that you bear much fruit, showing yourself to be my disciple. We must be Christians and churches who are marked out by the anointing of God. For as Jesus said, without me, you can do nothing. But where there is unity, the anointing of God is released. Our goal must always be to follow the example of Jesus in loving one another as he showed love. For it is when we are humble and serving and generous and kind-hearted towards each other that we'll see great growth in ourselves, teams of 12, and churches. Most of us know about the Holy Spirit, but what a change will come to our lives and churches when we are all daily filled with the Holy Spirit. And that's what we need. above all else in our churches in the UK, Europe, and in so many nations. So here's how we can receive a great anointing for multiplication. Live a holy life, earnestly pray with all your heart, live in unity, and be filled with the Holy Spirit.
The G12 conference, learning all about how to be anointed to multiply, and I feel really challenged to pursue holiness. God works with clean vessels, and I feel inspired to pray earnestly to be filled with the Holy Spirit and to live in unity with my Christian brothers and sisters.
What an incredible conference. From beginning to end, really just felt the anointing and the presence of God even at home. Each session just left you wanting more and more. Wow, what can I say? Just totally amazing.
Really inspired and encouraged by just to worship together, to receive the word, to hear testimonies of what God is doing in the church and in the churches, was really, really uplifting. And, you know, really challenged to live and be together with the Holy Spirit to see multiplication in my life and in my ministry.
I feel so challenged and encouraged by the conference. And as a mom of four, I love what Pastor Wes said, that when our children are filled with the Holy Spirit, they won't be rocked by this world, but instead they will rock the world.
The G12 conference really encouraged me because it taught me how to have a generous heart and how to serve other people. And watching all the preachers made me excited from when I can preach too.
There are two things that stood out for me. One is the expectancy. The expectancy that God is going to do great things through us as we trust him more. And the second thing is the authority that we need to walk in as children of God.
The G12 conference has been so incredible. There's been amazing worship, great interviews, testimonies, and every talk has been so impactful. And it's just so encouraging to see also the youth rising up into their calling as great leaders. It was truly such an incredible weekend.
Well, greetings to Pastor Wes, Pastor Adriana, to the whole team of pastors from G12 UK, and to everyone that is gathered connected to this conference. I pray for God's richest blessings upon every one of you. I know that what God has in store for the United Kingdom is supernatural. But you know, today, I would like for us to start by reading a scripture that is found in the book of Joel, chapter 2, verses 28 through 29. It says, "And it shall come to pass afterward that I will pour out my spirit on all flesh. Your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Your old men shall dream dreams. Your young men shall see visions." Today, I'd like to share a message called, "How Can We Transform the United Kingdom?" But let's start with a word of prayer. Dear Lord, today I am so grateful for the opportunity that you give us to gather here together, even if it's online. It's great to be gathered with all your children who love you and serve you in the United Kingdom. Lord, I pray that your anointing will come upon them, that during this conference, your grace, your favor, your mercy will be upon each and every single one of them. And Lord, I pray that they could feel that you are always with them, that you will always be upon them, and that you always lead every one of us from victory to victory. Thank you for the opportunity that you give us to share with your children who love you and serve you. We love you, O Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Now, we know that the time that we are living in is not easy all around the world because there are all kinds of circumstances to stir up society and the church, but still we need to stand strong in our faith and resist in the time of trial and keep ourselves standing in the promises that the Lord has given us. All around the world, the pandemic has produced a terrible social and financial crisis. But aside from that, every nation has had to deal with many needs. It's been a time, a difficult time, but that is exactly what the church, through the prophet Joel, that's why he gave us the promise of the Holy Spirit, because he could transform any situation. Back in the days of Jesus, there were rulers that had a terrible heart that brought about social crisis, and, you know, very similar to the migration crisis experienced in many places of the world today. Many believers were under the oppression of the Roman people, and they were awaiting a Messiah that would guide them to a great political reform or even to a war in order to take over power. But at the end of it all, they ended up understanding that true freedom could only be experienced in the Spirit and that authority comes upon a nation not through violence, but actually through the churches that actually understand the power of prayer. Those that are full and strengthened by the Holy Spirit are the ones that could truly be free, and they could transform the nations. In this case, I'm talking about the United Kingdom. And I think that this is the word that God has during this season for each and every one of you. Do not fix your eyes on the circumstances, whether it's a political or social situation, but fix your eyes. Give your best to be strengthened in the Spirit and endure in prayer so that you could obtain all the promises that God has in store for each and every one of you. Remember, you are constantly in our hearts and our prayers, and we know that you are brave and courageous people, and I know that the Lord is going to use you. He's going to use you in a mighty way so that the gospel could continue expanding all over the world. We need to remember that Jesus said, "Behold, I send the promise of my Father upon you, but tarry in the city of Jerusalem until you are endowed with power from on high." That is found in the Gospel of Luke, chapter 24 and verse 49. Notice that the Lord, he said to the disciples that they should not move from Jerusalem until they are endowed with power. There are moments where we need to be still in the place where God appointed us so that we could receive the anointing and the fullness of the Holy Spirit, and that is what will later move us to influence other nations. Now, as you know, the day of Pentecost was the beginning of the ministry of the Holy Spirit, because the Lord himself, he had said, "I will pour out my Spirit on all flesh," and that manifestation began where the 120 were in the upper room, and they began to pray in other tongues according to the utterance of the Spirit. And through that is where 300 Jews, they received Jesus in their hearts on that day when they heard the word that was spoken by the Apostle Peter. And from that moment forward, the church began to grow in an exponential manner, where every single day more people were being added to the church. And it says that the church was growing and the church was increasing. And then it says that the church was multiplying. But the revival, it came because the Holy Spirit visited the believers on the day of Pentecost. And I want to tell you, the time that we are living in are special days where the Lord himself, he wants to move in the same dimension, and he wants to use the Holy Spirit, where every one of his children are going to be connected to him in a supernatural way, because there is no time to waste. As you know, there is no middle ground anymore. Either people are Christians or they are the opposite. So Christians, we need to shake up from all conformity, and we need to begin to work influencing the lives of many people and try to lead as many people as we can to Jesus. Remember, Jesus making reference to the Holy Spirit, he said, "He will glorify me, for he will take of what is mine and declare it to you." And then he said, "All things that the Father has are mine. Therefore I said, he will take of mine and declare it to you." We need to understand that the Holy Spirit, he is the only one who manages God's riches. The Father and the Son, they share an infinite treasure, but the one in charge of revealing it and interpreting it is the Holy Spirit. All of God's capital is managed by the Spirit of God. The Father, he has a well full of all the things that man could ever need on this earth. Anyone who is longing to be blessed by the blessings of God, they need to have a good relationship with the Holy Spirit, and thus will have access to God's divine treasure that is found in the beautiful person of the Holy Spirit. A few years ago, one of our pastors, her name is Rosemary, she had an accident. She was in a car with her family. The car they were in suffered a terrible accident. One of the tires exploded and the car started turning over. And as the car was spinning and flipping, she realized that one of her daughters went flying towards the windshield of the car, but she used her arm to protect her, and the glass, it lacerated her arm, but she was able to save her daughter. For a long time, Rosemary had many surgeries so that she could be helped in her arm, and the doctors were not giving her any hope that her arm would be saved, that it would go back to functioning as before. But she decided to visit me. I was in Miami, and she told me, "I still have one more surgery to go, but my arm is dead, basically, because the nerves in my arm is basically gone." And so I said to her, "Look, we're going to pray because God is a miracle-working God." So I said, "Look, we're going to do something. We're going to go into the spiritual world where the Lord is, and there is a warehouse where God has all the resources we could need." So we prayed a prayer by faith, and we went into that heavenly warehouse where God has stored all the spare parts that our body could ever need. So we looked for our nation. We found Colombia. Then we looked for her family. We found her family. And then we looked for her name, and we found her name, Rosemary, and we found all the spare parts that her body could ever need, anything that she needed. So she needed nerves for her arm by faith. We took those nerves, we prayed a prayer, and we declared victory over her health. Well, 3 weeks later, when she was going to get her surgery, the doctor who had always treated her, when she was going to do the surgery, she was so excited. She started jumping and saying, "Your nerves are there. Your nerves are in your arm. Everything is perfect. How could it be?" And she said, "Well, look, I met a guy who helped me and put the nerves back in me." The doctor said, "You need to introduce that guy to me. We could get together. We could do business and we could become millionaires." And then she said, "Oh, no, you don't understand. The guy I'm talking to you is the Lord from above." And she was amazed. But in that moment is when the Spirit of God did the miracle. The God that we serve, he is not just any God. He is a God who restores. He is a God who breathes life. He is a God who helps us to conquer what many people think is impossible, but there is nothing impossible to God, because he came to save us, and that's why he gave his life for us. That's why he opened the floodgates of heaven, so that we could be a part of his people. And so we need to stand strong with him and never move to the left or right. The Apostle Paul said, "Likewise, the Spirit also helps us in our weaknesses, for we do not know what we should pray for as we ought, but the Spirit himself makes intercession for us with groanings which cannot be uttered." We need to understand that the Holy Spirit, he knows your need. And the interesting thing is that he intercedes with groanings which cannot be uttered in your favor. He is the best intercessor. That is why the best prayer is a prayer that is led by the Holy Spirit of God. I remember the day where I suffered the assassination attempt. I had taught my church how to pray, and I led them to pray a prayer, a true prayer, with groanings which cannot be uttered, which is more powerful than words, to show them. I even dramatized dramatized and showed them how they needed to worship. So I fell on my knees and began to worship God, and I taught them, as you intercede, there is more groaning there than words. And we also applied the blood of Jesus, and we prayed such a powerful prayer. Anyways, when we finished our prayer, we felt victory. We felt triumph because we had spent a time of spiritual warfare. And that day, when we did that amazing intercession, was the day of my daughter Lorena's 13th birthday. As a family, we had plans to have lunch together with the whole family. And so the car that I was driving was full of people. My daughters were there, my wife was there, a few of my nieces and nephews, and they were all worshiping God. But when I got on the car, I could see a person. When he saw me getting on the car, immediately he grabbed his phone and made a call. And I thought, wow, there's something odd that I don't like. So I went on a different route. But eventually, I had to go to our main avenue, which is 30th Avenue, which is our main avenue. When I went back to it, I looked on the rearview mirror. I saw two men on a motorcycle. And as soon as they saw me, immediately, they accelerated. And I had to stop at a red light. But I was looking at them all the time. I was seeing that they were following me. So as soon as I saw that they were next to me, immediately I turned around, and that is when they started shooting at me. Well, thanks to the fact that I turned my head towards them, they aimed at my head, but the bullet, it was aimed at the side of my head, but when I turned my head, it ended up grazing the back of my head, and then another bullet hit me in the neck. It came in on the left and went out on the right. Two hit me in the chest, and the last one that was aimed at my heart, it ended up hitting my watch. It was a watch that I had actually bought the day before. It was made of stainless steel, and the steel deflected the bullets. And that was the most dangerous bullet. My wife, she was also shot at in her left arm. The bullet crossed her arm. It was going to her heart, but it deviated, and it ended up a few millimeters away. When I was shot, I was out. And when that happened, the spirit began to fly away at a very fast speed. It was so fast. It was amazing. But my wife, when she saw that there was no reaction to me, she placed her arm on my arm, and she spoke with authority, and she said, "Cesar, you're not dying." And I heard another voice from above. I knew it was the voice of God that said, "Do you believe you will live or die?" And he left it up to me. And I said, "No, I cannot die." And I spoke the scripture that I had spoken of that morning. And I said, "I cannot die, because if the spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in me, he who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to my mortal body through his spirit who dwells within me." And when I spoke that verse, immediately the spirit came back to my body. I opened my eyes and I said to my wife, "How are the girls?" "Turn the car off." And immediately, someone took me to the hospital. As you could see, there are circumstances that you don't expect to experience. But the Lord himself, he knows when you need to leave this world. And I thought, well, maybe it was time for me to go. But I thank God that my wife, she was next to me, and she is the one who called me. And God used her so that I could come back. Now, that experience marked my whole family, because we saw that there is a God who protects us and saves us. But he marked us not negatively, but in a very positive way, because we know that there is a God who fights for us. And not so long ago, actually last week, my 13th granddaughter, Sarah Esther, a few days ago, my granddaughter, Sarah Esther, in a very unexpected moment, ended up falling into the swimming pool at about 9 a.m. My daughter, she had been looking after her. They were about to leave the house. She was with my son-in-law, Lausinho, and the whole family was ready to go to church. And Sarah, she suddenly thought, where is little Sarah Esther? And in a matter of seconds, it turns out that she had gone somewhere. When my daughter went to look for her at the pool, she found that she had drowned. Immediately, she took her out of the water. It happened in just seconds. She took her out of the water, but there was no life in her. She was pale. There was no sign of life at all. And she started saying to her husband, please do something. And he took little Sarah Esther and he began to practice cardiopulmonary resuscitation. I was at that moment in another city called Cartagena, and I got a call from Sarah. She was crying. She said to my wife, Mom, my daughter, little Sarah, she's dead. She has drowned. She's dead. And my wife, she started praying. And she started shouting and crying out to God. And then she put me on the phone. And I said to Sarah, I said to my daughter, Sarah, we need to trust God. The God that has given me life, the God that has brought me back, He is with us. And when I began to pray for little Sarah Esther, I could see that she had already gone. And because I've been through that before, I knew, I understood how to pray, and I began to speak to my granddaughter, Sarah Esther. I speak to you, come back to your body. It is an order that I speak, come back now to your body. Come back right now. And I ordered that she come back to her body. And then I heard my granddaughter cry. When I heard my granddaughter cry, I said, thank you, Lord. Thank you. Thank you because you have done the miracle. Thank you because you have brought my little granddaughter back to life. And though a few minutes passed that were very tense, but just by hearing her cry, I knew that the miracle had been done. And it took them quite a while to get to the hospital, but the Lord was glorified on that day. She was hospitalized for 4 days. She was in the hospital, and the doctors were astonished because with all that she experienced, with all that she went through, and to see the way in which she was recovering and coming back to life. And when they did all kinds of examination, but they could not find anything wrong. And I knew it because our God, when He does a miracle, He never does them halfway. He does everything perfect. And the doctors at the hospital were saying to my daughter, your daughter is a miracle. The doctors that visited, they said, I've come to visit the miracle child. Why? Because God brought her back. I'm telling you, we serve an awesome God. We have a mighty God. He is a God who overcame death. He is a God who says that there is nothing impossible to Him. And remember, if God is for us, who could ever be against us? Our God, He is the one who keeps us, who protects us. He is the one who helps us so that we could arise, so that we could conquer. And God, He needs for us to be healthy, but also to be awake in the Spirit, to be able to influence other people. Remember that we don't have much time left, the time that we're going to be here on this earth. We don't know how long it is, but we need to take advantage of every moment by winning lots of souls. We need to come out of our comfort zone and say to the people that there is a living God, a real God, and we need to make the effort so that they could turn back to God and have a supernatural experience with the Lord. And that is why, dear pastors, dear leaders, dear disciples, dear men and women of God, dear families in the Lord, I recommend that you turn back to God with all your heart. Turn back to Him with all your soul, with all your might. God will never forsake you. But today, I'd like to pray a prayer for you that the Lord Himself will be glorified and break every single chain of oppression. Please, place your right hand on your heart, and we are going to pray a prayer for you. Father, right now, I present every one of your children to you, those that are connected to this conference, those that are connected to this teaching, those who are listening to the word, even though they are online, yet I know that your anointing and your hand is upon them. And I pray that every chain be broken. I pray that every bondage be released right now. Leave them. I pray that you breathe your breath of life. I pray that you give them abundant life to each and every one of your children, so that they could teach and preach your name all over the earth. Because, Lord, we believe that you are a God of miracles. We believe that you are a mighty God, and we believe there is nothing impossible to you. And those who do not know you, Lord, I pray that they could experience an encounter with you. I pray that you do this in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Amen. And to every one of you, thank you so much for the opportunity of sharing the Word of God, experiences of God with you. And I pray that the Lord will bless you. May the Lord be with you. And I pray that He will make you and your families priestly families. Lots of love. May the Lord be with you.
Be it for me to not believe, even when my eyes can't see, and this mountain that's in front of me will be thrown into the midst of the sea. Through it all, through it all, are on you. Through it all, through it all, it is well. Through it all, through it all, my eyes are on you. It is well with me. So let go, my soul.
So let go, my soul.
is well with me.
Thank you for joining us today. If you have any prayer requests, please contact us at hello@kcionline.org. Or for more information about our church, please visit our website at kcionline.org. To stay connected with us, please go to kcionline.org/connect. Or if you would like to find out more about giving, please go to kcionline.org/giving. And to listen to all our services, go to kcionline.org/podcast or simply download the KCI app on the App Store. Don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube channel of King's Church International and our senior pastors Wes and Adriana. We welcome you to join us again every Sunday at 5 p.m. UK time. God bless you.